but he doesn't get paid for that. And he's pretty good at cutting hair as well, but he doesn't get paid for that either. And what he is a preacher, and that's what he's called to. And, you know, if you could ask him about it, I know he would tell you that he himself is amazed at the life that God's allowed him to live and of the privilege of getting to live as a preacher. What a wonderful thing that is, to get to do what every person is made for and to do it full time. And so that's a wonderful thing. My concern this evening is that as a church, we do right. We would not want to, I never want to be a person who takes advantage of anyone everywhere. I know that any person who doesn't do right by their preacher, God just doesn't bless. I know also that those who have a heart to give and are generous about their giving, that God does bless. And I want God's blessing in my life, and I also want to be a blessing. I want God to use me. And so as we give this evening, we would just ask that you would very, very carefully pray and ask God, God, what would you have me to give? We'll have two more opportunities tomorrow evening and Wednesday as well. God, what would you have to give? And the way I usually ask it is this, God, how much can I give? God, what can I give? And as I'm praying about it, and as you're praying about it, God will lead us with exactly what the needs are of the Thompson family. Now, he's got a nice truck, doesn't he?
Yes.
You noticed?
Yes, he does.
Beautiful truck. It's a Ford and everything. And it's a nice looking truck. Matter of fact, many of you guys would probably say, well, I'd like to have a truck like that. Well, you could maybe trade your house in and have a truck like that, but you couldn't probably have both. That's their home, and that's how they move their home around. And if you understand what it costs to just the logistics of having a portable home and the things that break on portable homes and those sort of things, you'd understand what their physical needs are. And so I'd ask that you take that into consideration as well as you pray about giving. We certainly want to not just do right by them, but we want to be a blessing. And so as we give this evening, I would just ask that you would prayerfully consider those things. And again, we'll have two more opportunities to give specifically to the ministry of the Thompson family. And so let's pray and let's ask God to show us what we should do tonight. Father, we do need your leading. Lord, it would not impress you for us to misallocate anything. So God, if we have finances that you have entrusted us as stewards with, and we use them for something other than taking care of our preacher, Lord, that would be wrong. As well, Father, it would be wrong if we used finances that we weren't supposed to give this evening. And so what we need tonight is exactly to know your heart, to know exactly what you want. And what we need as well is just to simply be yielded and full of faith to trust you by your grace to enable us to give what you've shown us that we ought to. And as a result of this, Lord, I pray that you'd meet the needs of the Thompson family. I pray that you would meet the housing needs that they have, the ministry needs that they have. And Lord, I just pray that you would allow us ultimately to be used by you to be very generous in our giving this week. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand.
as we sing hymn number 374, Jesus Calls Us.
Last. to rise and fall. God's word outlives them all. It will stand the test of time, for its author is divine. I will proudly call it mine, the word of God. Though nations rise and fall, God's word outlives them all. It will stand the test of time, for its author is divine. So I will proudly call it mine, the word of God. And I certainly am glad I have the word of God to stand on, aren't you? Without it, we have no foundation. Thank God for His blessed word, His precious word, that is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. I'm grateful that I do not have to wonder at what God thinks about things. Not all things in the scriptures do I understand, but everything I need to know, I can find out in the word of God. I'm glad for that. We're living the book of Luke tonight. Luke, and we're going to look together at chapter number 1 of the book of Luke. Thanks for coming out on Monday night. How many of you had like a normal Monday today in the sense that it was like, wow, this is like everything dumps on all at once kind of day? It happened almost every Monday for us. Now, usually we start revival meetings on Sunday, and so Monday is like our, okay, we come in on Saturday night, we get parked, we find out all the problems with the church's electricity, all the problems with the church's water, all the problems with where we were supposed to park, everything else. And Saturday night, Sunday morning, you get up and you go, and I usually speak about 3 times on Sunday, so we're going till late Sunday night, and then Monday morning, we get up, and it's kind of like you breathe for a moment, and then you get going at it, and it's like everything all of a sudden just dumps on. Everything has to happen that didn't happen on the weekend, and so that's kind of how Mondays are. I think it's that way for just about everybody. So if you had a normal Monday, hey, congratulations. We're all in the same boat together, but I trust it was a good day. If not, then I hope that starting now, you'll enjoy the rest of your Monday. I do the things that we're going to look at tonight. I am fully convinced of this, and I think it's something important, valuable. I think that what we're about to look at in a moment, the truth we're about to learn, is one of the truths that for outreach purposes, for the opportunities to spread the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, the truth we're about to see will be literally, it'll be life-changing. It'll be ministry-altering if you get a hold of this. And I don't mean for the church necessarily as a whole, corporately, but for each of us individually. If each person here tonight will catch a hold of this, it will change the way you see life. And I trust that that is true and that the message tonight will get through to our hearts as well as our heads and our consciences so that we can live by it. Let me get to the right passage here. Luke chapter number 1. Now, typically I have folks stand out of respect for the scriptures. However, tonight I'm going to read a large number of verses. And so the rule is when I read a large number of verses, I'll let you stay sitting. But you have to promise me that you will stay keyed in, clued in, on what's being read. I'll do my best to read with word color to give emphasis. I'll stop and say some things along the way in order to keep you involved, but you have to do your part. And especially after a Monday and a busy weekend that we just had. During this time, this is not the time to let your mind wander and wonder how many light bulbs light the auditorium. This is not the time to count. There's 42. You don't have to count. So I don't know that. I'm making it up. But don't count to find out during this time. All right? So we're going to read beginning in verse number 5, and basically we're going to read a historical account that is the predating of the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Luke chapter 1, and we're going to begin in verse number 5, and see the story in your mind as it unfolds, all right? The Bible says, verse number 5, "There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias of the course of Abia, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth." So thus far, we have 2 players in this historical account. Give me their names, would you please? Number 1 is?
Zacharias.
And number 2 is?
Elizabeth.
Elizabeth. So we have Zacharias and Elizabeth. I'm glad you didn't say Aaron. All right, so it's Zacharias and Elizabeth, and they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord. They were blameless. So let me ask you a question. Were Zacharias and Elizabeth, were they good people?
Yes.
Did they follow the Lord?
Yes.
Yeah, they did. They loved God. And they had no child because Elizabeth was barren. And they both were now well-stricken in years. Okay, give me a three-letter word that means well-stricken in years.
Oh.
Okay, that's what they were. And it came to pass that while he, Aaron, executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot, or his job, was to burn incense when he went to the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense, and there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar. Hey, see this in your brain. Let your mind see it. This was on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, "Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. Thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice in his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." And Zacharias said unto the angel, "Whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is well stricken in years." And the angel answering said unto him, "I am Gabriel, to stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, not able to speak, until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my word, which shall be fulfilled in their season." And the people waited for Zacharias and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak unto them. And they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned unto them, but he remained speechless. And it came to pass that as soon as the days of his ministration were accomplished, he departed to his own house. And after those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived and hid herself 5 months, saying, "Thus hath the Lord dealt with me in the days where he looked on me to take away my reproach among men." And in the 6th month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. So now we've added Joseph and Mary to the story. And the angel came in unto her and said, "Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women." And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end." Then said Mary unto the angel, "How shall this be, seeing I know not a man?" And the angel answered and said unto her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the 6th month with her who is called barren." Now look at verse 37. "For with God nothing shall be impossible." Hey, do you mind just reading verse 37 with me? I'll give the reference and you read it out loud with me. Luke 1, verse 37. "For with God, nothing shall be impossible." Emphasize the name God in it, would you please? Here we go, Luke 1, 37. "For with God, nothing shall be impossible." Emphasize the word nothing. Ready? Luke 1, 37. "For with God, nothing shall be impossible." Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I pray that tonight you'd help us to learn from this passage what both you intended for us to learn and that which I think you've placed on my heart for this group tonight. I pray, dear God, that it would find lodging in the minds of every person that's here, in their hearts, and in, as I've said already to you, Father, in their consciences. Lord, I do ask that you'd help those who are struggling with fatigue, who've just had a rough day or a big day or a busy day, and the temptation would be for the mind to wander, and that would be the most natural thing in the world. I pray that you give them an extra measure of your grace to be able to stay alert so that they can hear this very important truth. And then, Father, along with that, help me to be succinct with what I say so as not to muddy up what needs to be said for any purpose other than just sharing what the truth is. Father, we believe your word is given to us for the purpose of teaching us things that we need to know, and that it holds your very, this Bible holds your very words in it, and what you say you mean, and what you mean has power. It has strength because it comes from you. So, Lord, please help us tonight to get what we need to get. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask these things. Amen. Did you know that all of us are limited?
Yes.
How many of you are already aware of that you have limitations? Okay. When we think of that, most often we think of our physical limitations. That is, there are things physically that we can't do. And as we get older, those things increase. Taj, true? Okay. So there are things that you used to be able to do, like play basketball, that you can't do anymore without pulling something, breaking something, falling apart. Or my dad, who's in his 70s, will say on occasion, he'll say, my mind will make appointments that my body cannot keep. In other words, my brain tells me I can still do this, but when I try to do it, it just doesn't happen anymore. Okay, as you get a little older, that becomes more of a reality. When you're young, you know, you feel like you have the world by the tail. You can do anything you put your mind to, but even in reality, there's always a level at which we are limited as to what we can do. Physically, that is true. Have any of you ever been to the Grand Canyon out in Arizona? Okay, if you go to the Grand Canyon, you look across from one side to the other, you're looking across 12 miles. It's not possible to jump from one side of the Grand Canyon to the other. If you look down, you're looking down 5,000 feet to the bottom, almost a mile, and you can see the Colorado River snaking through. If the best jumper in the world, if I were to train and get in the best shape of my life, round is a shape, I know, but if I were to get into the best shape of my life, like physical fit, and I were to determine that I was going to jump across the Grand Canyon, I back up in Arizona, and I run as fast as I can and plant my foot perfectly on the edge and leap as hard as I can. Do you know how far I would make it? 5,000 feet. Down. You know, boing, 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 and splat. Why? Well, because it's not physically possible to jump across 12 miles with our human body. You just can't do it. Physically, we're limited. Mentally, we're limited. Anybody have a mom who ever said something along the lines of, I have had it up to here? You ever had a mom or a parent or a teacher that said something like that? I'm not sure what happens if it gets up here, but I'm still alive, so I'm assuming I never quite reached that place. Okay, what my mom was saying when she would say that to my brothers is, she was saying, I have mentally, emotionally taken all I can take. I have reached my limit. Well, we're limited. There are things we can't do. Luke 1 and what we just read, among other things, teaches us, and it's summarized in verse number 37, that God Jehovah is the one true God who is not limited like we are. He is the God of the impossible. With God, nothing is impossible. And that is exactly what is seen in the story, or actually the stories that we just read about Zacharias and Elizabeth and about Mary and Joseph. We see, in essence, God displaying the fact that he's the God of the impossible. Now, I want your involvement tonight. So I want you to respond back, and this will just help us stay on course, help us to get through it quickly, succinctly, but also make sure that you're staying with me. All right? If I were to say to you, in this story, or the two stories that we just read, Zacharias, Elizabeth, Mary, and Joseph, we see two impossibilities take place. We see God show himself as the God of the impossible in two ways. Now, actually, there's three ways that we'll look at tonight. But if I were to say there's two ways, could you tell me the first way in the passage in Luke 1, let's say, surrounding the lives of Zacharias and Elizabeth, could you tell me how God reveals himself to be the God of the impossible? And go ahead and say it out loud. How does God show himself to be the God of the impossible in Luke 1, beginning with the story of Zacharias and Elizabeth? Okay. I would say, according to what the Bible says, the barren conceives. And basically, you have Zacharias and Elizabeth. The Bible tells us just a little bit about them. We know they were righteous. We know they were blameless. We know that they prayed about having children. But seemingly, God had said no. And then the angel comes to Zacharias and says, you're going to have a son. But Zacharias says, we're old. My wife is no spring chicken. It just can't happen. Yet, the barren conceives. Now, why is that? Why is it that a lady who's past the age of physically being able to have a children. Now, I'm sure when she was younger, she did everything she could do. She went to the doctors and she tried all the herbs. And if they had Google, she would have Googled it to figure out anything that would help. She wanted to have a child, and yet God had said no to her. And yet now, in her old age, she has a child. Why? Why does she have a child in her old age? And the answer is, for with God, nothing shall be impossible. Because He's God. And He's not limited like you and I are limited. And though things may seem impossible to us, God can do things that are impossible. Okay, what is the second? In this story, what is the second way that we see God demonstrate the fact that He's the God of the impossible? In fact, let me give you a hint. It's about Mary. And the first part is the barren conceives. The second way that God shows Himself to be the God of the impossible is that the virgin conceives. Okay, time out. And if the barren conceiving is impossible, then the virgin conceiving is really impossible. I mean, in today's time, with science advancing as it has, it is possible for a scientist to do a lot of things that they could not have done in this day. But even today, outside of God giving life, life cannot begin any other way. Life is God's to give. And so here's the virgin. Here's Mary. And she's not married. I mean, she's married, but she's not married. She's engaged to Joseph. She's not played fast and loose. She's been right. She's done things that are right in a right way. And now the angel says, you're going to have a baby. And sure enough, she does. And I ask you again, why is it that the virgin conceives? And the answer is, because with God, what? Nothing is impossible. He's the God of the impossible. He can cause the barren to conceive. He can cause the virgin to conceive. But in this story, there's one more impossible thing that takes place. When these two stories come together in a very special and divine way, that if you're not careful, you miss, and I think it's the whole point that the stories are given to us in the first place. Mary and Joseph missed it. Zacharias and Elizabeth missed it. The third impossibility of what takes place in this passage. Now please, hear what I'm telling you, because this is the whole reason why we're gathering together. The third impossibility that takes place in this passage is this. That the Son of God was born. The Messiah was coming. We say, what's so impossible about that? That God would take on flesh for the purpose of redeeming sinful mankind back to Himself. The promises of thousands of years of prophecies and pictures, all in this moment on earth, fulfilled. All of history and all of eternity, as far as mankind is concerned, is centered around this point. And the greatest miracle of all miracles in all of the Scripture, greater than the seeing being calmed, and greater than the blind receiving their sight, or the deaf receiving their hearing, or the lame being able to walk, greater than what Elijah and Elisha did by the power of God, greater than the barren conceiving and greater than the virgin conceiving, is the fact that God would take on flesh and that Jesus Christ would come to this earth in order to provide for you and for I complete forgiveness of sins so that we might be children of God. That great miracle of Luke chapter 1 is not primarily that the barren conceive or that the virgin conceive. But the great miracle of Luke chapter 1 is the fact that Jesus Christ the Son of the God was born. Now, I want you to see this. I want you to look back at Luke chapter 1, and I want to start looking in verse number 12 of Luke chapter 1, where the story begins, and I want you to see the response of Zacharias and the response of Mary to the messages that they received, and how it mirrors us often, and how it needs to instruct us regarding how we live. Look down at verse number 12 of Luke chapter 1. The Bible says, when Zacharias saw the angel, he was troubled and fear fell upon him. The angel said unto him, "Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. Thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. Thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth." Well, yeah, that makes sense to me. "For he shall be great," that is, your son, John, "will be great in the sight of the Lord. He shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall return to the Lord their God." Okay, now immediately, this when Zacharias hears this, he ought to have an antenna go up, because this is different than what most people's children... I mean, that he's going to be born, he's going to have the Spirit on him, even when he's in his mother's womb, and his job, his calling. Now, verse number 17 says this. This is the angel speaking to Zacharias. See that in your mind. "And he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Okay, time out. Now, please, 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 don't miss this, okay? When the angel says this to Zacharias, immediately the bells ought to go off in his brain. The flags ought to come up. What the angel Gabriel says here about that when he is born, he's going to go before him in the spirit and power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. This is a direct quote from the Old Testament, the prophecies that were given about the coming of the Messiah, about the coming of the Anointed One, the greatest miracle of all miracles. And every Jewish man who loved Jehovah God, every Jewish man who believed the Bible, what they had of it, every Jewish man desired, begged, pleaded with God that they would be able to be alive when the peace, the consolation of Israel, when the Messiah came, when the great miracle took place. And there were prophecies that had been given to the people of Israel so that they would have an idea about when the Messiah was going to come and how he was going to come and what things would surround them. And one of the clearest prophecies was the fact that before the Messiah came, there would come someone in the spirit and power of Elias in order to prepare the way for the Lord, so that when Zacharias heard from the angel... Now, forgive me for allowing my imagination to be displayed to you, because the Bible doesn't tell us this. But in my mind's eye, when I read this, I think about what kind of emotion the angel would have had, if angels have emotion at all, and I'm assuming that they do. I'm thinking to myself, because all of heaven is keyed in on this point for the purpose of earth. The angels are a part of God's plan in bringing about redemption of mankind in the coming of the Messiah. So in my mind's eye, I see the angel coming to deliver this message. Here comes Gabriel to deliver this message to Zacharias, and I'm thinking, on the way down from heaven, he's thinking to himself, this is going to be great. I mean, Zacharias is going to be so excited. And what a great guy for God to choose to allow his son to be the precursor for the coming of the Messiah. This is the angel in his mind. This is just what I imagine. When I get there and deliver this message and tell him who his son is going to be, he is going to come unglued. I mean, he is going to be so excited. He's going to be beside himself. This is going to be great. And so here's the angel. He comes. He says, "Zacharias, don't be afraid. I have news for you," he says to him. "You're going to have a son. And your son's going to be great. He's going to be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb. Zacharias, he's going to go before him in the spirit and power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the wisdom and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And Zechariah says, how can this happen? Seeing I'm old and my wife is well stricken in years, how can this be? And the angel Gabriel, you can see it, the angel Gabriel picked up Zacharias by the coat and he slapped him across the face several times and he set him down. No, this didn't happen, but if I had been the angel, this is what I would have done. He said, Zacharias, I am telling you that your son is going to be the predecessor of the Messiah. The Messiah is coming, the great miracle of all miracles. That which has been promised since the Garden of Eden is finally being, it's coming to pass, and your son is preparing the way. The Messiah is coming, and you're concerned about a little thing like being too old to have a baby? Seriously, Zacharias. All right, fast forward 6 months. Gabriel comes to Mary. Hail, highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. And she's troubled, and the angel says, you're going to have a son. Let's look at it together. Look with me at verse number 31. Behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Be it unto thy handmaid, even as thou hast said, this is a glorious day. The Messiah is coming, and I get to give birth to him. Is that what she says? She says, how can this be, seeing I know not a man? Okay, now, from other passages of Scripture, I don't believe that Mary's question was asked in unbelief, but rather, it was an honest question of, okay, how is this supposed to take place? Am I supposed to marry Joseph? What's supposed to happen in order for this to take place? But still, you gotta wonder, when the angel says to her, your son is going to be the Son of the Highest. He's going to be the Son of God. His kingdom will never end. He's going to reign over the house of Jacob forever. That Mary would have thought to herself, wow, the greatest miracle of all miracles is taking place. God is doing something great and he's chosen me. This is glorious. But instead, immediately, now look, with both Zacharias and with Mary, immediately when they hear the news about his son, her son, and how and what's going to take place, their immediate response is, I just don't see how this is possible. I'm old. I'm a virgin. How can this take place? How's it going to happen? Okay, now look, here's what happened. Here's the reason, and this is the whole point. I'm going to say this, I'm going to illustrate it a couple ways, and our time is done. What happens is Zacharias and Mary were so focused on what physically touched them, on what physically seemed to be difficult, on what physically seemed to be impossible, that they absolutely missed the great miracle of what God was really doing. They were focused on old and virgin, and God was sending his son. They were consumed with, this is impossible, but God was saying, I am doing something far bigger, far greater, far more eternal than just causing the barren to conceive or a virgin to conceive. I'm sending my son. There's something greater at stake, something bigger at stake. And I gotta tell you, I need to live my life with my eyes not primarily focused on what physically touches me, but rather asking God for his vision, his eyes, to see what it is he might be doing.
You're right.
We get so full and so focused on what seems to be impossible to us, and we go to God regarding it. It's not that we shouldn't go to God. In other words, it's not like if I have something that's difficult for me or hard for me, I shouldn't come to God and say, God, deliver me from this. But sometimes we do that at the expense, without the consideration that in the difficulty, God may be doing something far bigger, far greater, far more eternal. He may be working a plan that you and I may not be able to see right away with our physical eyes, but if we will stop and ask God to help us to see what it is He is doing, we may have greater cause to rejoice in our difficulty than to just immediately go, God, deliver me from this. Can you see this? Zacharias and Mary both so focused on what was physically impossible. How could it be? I'm old. How could it be? I'm a virgin. That they missed the fact that the Christ was coming. They should have been rejoicing in that moment, but they could not rejoice because of what physically seemed difficult. Okay, so two illustrations, and then I'll summarize and our time's done. One illustration's made up, one's for real. First, the made up illustration. Let's say you leave Fort Lauderdale, you're driving down the road, you go out of town, you're headed down to the Keys, you're going across, and you're out in no man's land. You get some of that, not much of it, but a little bit of it between here and there. No cell phone reception, it's 10 o'clock at night, all of a sudden you have a flat tire. And you're driving down, you get a flat tire, you pull over. As you're pulling over, you think to yourself, oh no. I took my spare out the other day in order to get more stuff in my trunk. I don't have my spare. I don't have a jack. I can't do anything. I have no reception. Oh, it's 10:30 at night. God, oh God, deliver me, please. Help me out of this situation. And you sit there for a minute, and you're talking to God, and all of a sudden a pickup truck pulls up behind you. And it's not just a pickup truck, but it's a good old boy in a pickup truck. And the good old boy in the pickup truck has like six spare tires in his in the bed of his truck. And he gets out and he has a spare tire that fits your car. And he has a jack. This guy lives for this moment of when he can get out and help somebody who's in trouble. And he gets out and he changes your tire. He picks up the car with a jack. He puts on the new tire. He lets down the car. He sends you on your way. And you leave and you say, God, thank you. Thank you, God, for sending me a tire. God, you delivered me from this. Oh, you delivered Daniel from the lions. Then you delivered Joseph out of the hands of his brothers. And you delivered me from this situation. God, you are so good. You sent me a tire. Now forgive me. And God in heaven says, no.
I sent you a soul.
I didn't send you a tire. I sent you a person. I sent you someone who needed me, who's searching. I'm not saying that every time a person comes in contact with us, that it's always God sending them to us because we're supposed to tell them. But I'm saying, listen, I'm saying that nothing in our life happens by accident. That God's in charge of it all. And sometimes we're so, why am I stuck in this line? I don't have time for this conversation with these people right now. God, please, can you get me out of this? I don't want to sit by that. And we are so focused on what physically pushes against us, touches against us, that we miss the fact we are so human vision oriented that we miss that God may be doing something so much bigger, so much greater. Second illustration, true story. Brittany and I have a friend whose name is Karen Roberts. She lives in Central Florida. Ever since we've known Karen, I've never seen her, or very seldom have I seen her, when she's not pulling an oxygen cart or else carrying on her side a machine that makes oxygen with tubes running to her nose in order for her to be able to breathe. Karen has had cancer ever since we've known her. We've known her for about 14 years. She has congestive heart failure, And there's no reason on this earth that Karen should be alive. We thought we'd lost her so many times. Our family started praying for Karen on a regular basis, and for several years, every day, we prayed, God, we don't know exactly what you want, but we would love it if you'd wipe the cancer out of Karen's body. Please, would you please deliver from this cancer? Karen's prayer request was a little bit different. Karen would pray, God, I would like to live long enough to see my children trust Christ. And she said, I would like to live long enough to see my doctor trust Christ. Now, her children are now both either teenagers or grown and out of the house. They both trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. Her doctor was a Jehovah's Witness and married to a third generation Jehovah's Witness. And Jehovah's Witness do not believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the God, that He's God in flesh. They're not saved. You probably know that. And they're very indoctrinated in what they've been taught, but it's not true according to the Scriptures. So Karen was having a real bad time. She goes to this lady doctor, goes to a doctor, and the doctor says, Karen, you don't have long to live. It doesn't look good. And Karen said, I know, but it's all right. And the doctor said to her, Karen, you have something that I don't have. And Karen said, well, let me tell you about the Lord Jesus. And told her about Christ again. And Karen's doctor trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. Gave a Bible to the doctor's husband. He read for a year the book of John, and after a year he trusted Jesus Christ as Savior. The doctor and her husband moved up to the Northeast. Karen went on, still struggled in her health. Karen was not doing well, got a hold of her doctor up in the Northeast, and the doctor said, I've got to get to you. I've got to put my hands on you and see what's going on. So she's going to fly down, and Karen was super excited because she was coming down on Resurrection Sunday, and she was going to go to church with Karen. And so Karen was super excited about it. And she was waiting at the church, and the doctor was supposed to be there, didn't get there. Eventually, she called the doctor's husband, got a hold of him, and found out that when she had landed, she got in a rental car, and on the way over, she had gotten in a wreck, and she had been killed. So let me ask you, do you think that Karen would like to be rid of her cancer? I mean, do you think Karen would like to be healed, be able to live and enjoy life with her husband, and enjoy life with her kids, and be able to get out and do activities and not feel bad? Do you think she would like to be healed of cancer?
Yes.
Yeah. Do you think Karen would trade her cancer if she could go back and not have it at all?
No.
Not on your life. Why? Because when you live with God's vision, there are things that are greater. There are things that are bigger. So that the things that we naturally go, God, this is uncomfortable. This is impossible. God, if I'm going to be healed, it's only going to be you. God, please deliver me. Those things have with them the opportunity to see that God may be doing something bigger, greater, and more eternal. And when you consider living with cancer versus a soul spending eternity separated from God in a place called hell, well, the weight shifts all of a sudden. My prayer, after reading this passage and seeing what it was that Zacharias and Mary missed, when I saw this, my prayer became, and this is the challenge, my prayer became, God, please, give me your vision. Give me your vision for what it is you're doing. It's not wrong for me to ask to be delivered from cancer. It's not wrong for me to ask to be let out of a situation that's uncomfortable. We're supposed to bring a request to God, but in all of it, God, help me to see things as you see them, so that accidental bump-ins, I recognize, oh, God may be doing something. That things that are uncomfortable, oh, God may be opening up an opportunity. I get in a fender bender. Oh, God, this may be. Just always aware. And then if God chooses to show me what He's doing, then great. If He doesn't, I just trust that He is working behind the scenes. That He's doing things that I could never understand. So my challenge to you tonight, or rather the challenge to you tonight, not mine, but God's challenge to you tonight, hey, are you living with God vision? Instead of saying, oh, this is uncomfortable, let me out. Are you living with God vision? I wish I never had gone through that. But what about the doors of opportunity God will open up through this for eternal value? Don't despise the things that God allows, but rather look for the things that God may be doing through it. And God help us to have His vision. So let me ask you, is that where you live? Don't answer out loud, but think. Is that where you live? Right now, is that where you live? I mean, do you live in the midst of, God, give me your vision. God, today, help me to be aware of what you may be doing instead of being focused only physically on what touches me, on what I have to get done. Is that where you live? Well, if not, then why don't you determine tonight just to begin to ask God to give you His vision? And you'll forget sometimes, but ask God to bring it back to your mind. And perhaps in your morning prayer time, if you ever write down things that you're going to pray for, just write down God vision. God vision, so that it's daily on your mind. That today, whatever I face, whatever comes, God may be doing something through it. Amen. All right? So let's talk to the Lord about it. Right now, I'm going to pray. When I'm done, as I pray, if God's dealt in your heart, why don't you just ask God for His vision? Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm thinking right now, Father, of something recent where I was very much aware of what physically was touching me, but not very much aware of what you may have been doing or may be doing. And so, Father, on my behalf, I ask you right now for your vision, your eyes, to see things the way that you see them, instead of being so totally focused on what physically touches me. And Father, may this be constantly on our minds, not in such a way so as to wear us down, but just to make us aware. Keep us alert, dear Father. You know how often our spiritual ears are deaf. Keep us alert to what it is you may be doing. And may we rest, even when we cannot see, may we rest in the fact that you are a God who works all things for your glory and our best good. Now, Father, if there are some people right now who are going through situations where it's difficult to get their eyes off of what physically is touching them, I pray that you give them the grace right now by your Spirit to have your vision, to see things as you see them. Help us to pray that way, to think that way, and to rest in you in that way. I ask this, Father, of you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and for your glory. Amen. Pastor?
Thank you for being here this evening. And as you see, the Lord leading at the preaching one night at a time, I look forward to it as well, seeing what God leads tomorrow night and Wednesday evening. If you'll be here, God will move. God will speak to you. And I look forward to God moving me and speaking to me. And I'll be the first to say, I need revival. I need God to use my life. If God uses our life, we have purpose. We have a reason for living. So many times, our reason for living isn't the same as what God made us for. God made you for something. You're very, very precious to Him. You're very, very special to Him. And He wants to use you. He wants to use you in this church. And so we thank you, Brother Thompson, for preaching the Word of God to us this evening. We look forward to being back. I want to dismiss as quickly as I can tonight because you need rest. And need to be able to be here. I understand what it is to ask people to come to services a lot of nights in a row, but we need it. And so let's put the effort in to be ready for what God has for us tomorrow night. Father, thank you for what you've done so far. Thank you for what you've shown us. And we ask you to continue the work in us. Prepare us even now for what we have to hear tomorrow. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You're dismissed. Thank you.
good. You?